And behold, a woman of Canaan came from the region and cried out to him. A woman came and cried out to him, saying, "Have mercy on me, O Lord." Excuse me. You have to bear with me, amen? And cried out to him, saying, "Have mercy on me, O Lord, Son of David. My daughter is severely demon-possessed." Now, I want to take you into Mark. So turn your Bibles in Mark chapter 7. What we'll find is the same story recorded here. But let me know, when you take the Gospels and you read the stories in the different Gospels, they complement one another. Because what you'll find is some of the things that are recorded in one are not recorded the exact same way, even though it's the same account. But you'll get some more details that you never got in the book of Matthew. You'll get in the book of Mark about this encounter and which happened. It's being seen from a different light and from a different perspective. So I want to read this part because I thought this stood out to me a lot. Verse 24. "And there he arose and went to the region of Tyre and Sidon, and he entered into the house and wanted no one to know it." You imagine that? That's Jesus. "It entered into the house and he wanted no one to know." You ever felt like that? You ever been like that? I get those moments sometimes. It's just like, I want to find a cave. I want to hide in it for just a little while. Well, no one to know I'm here. That's why Angie and I, we love vacation. We love fire vacations, where we go far, far away. We're getting ready to go on April the 20th, and we're going to be gone for about 10 or 11 days, I guess. 12 days. Mm-hmm. 2 weeks in total. I'm going to miss y'all, but I'm not going to miss you enough not to go. Amen? But we're planning on going there, and I love going away and just having those moments where you can just realize that you are separated. You'll notice Jesus did this quite often. He went up into the mountain. He said, "Hey, you guys go on over to the other side. I'll catch up with you." And he went up into the mountain, and he spent some time. And he went off by himself, and he spent some time. I mean, you all need, everybody say, we all need some time. Everybody needs some time. But, you know, in this situation, Jesus, he wanted to be alone. He wanted that time where he could just go into the house, and didn't want anybody to know it. But he could not be hidden. And many people have also experienced that, where you tried to get away, but you could not be hidden. You just can't happen. You're just too valuable. Everybody say, "I'm too valuable." You're too valuable. I mean, no, that's a good thing, but it can also become a troublesome thing. Because depending on much knowledge and wisdom and understanding you have in particular areas, for instance, if you know how to plaster and paint, don't tell no one. Because if you tell them you know how to plaster and paint, they'll be calling you up and saying, "Hey, what are you doing today?" Isn't that right, Paul? Amen? God bless you. If you know how to do those things, that's what happens. If you know anything about electrical, and somebody's got a problem with that, and they know you know about it, they're going to call you because they want your expertise. If you know anything about music and how to play an instrument, they're going to be trying to get your expertise. So, you are valuable. Say, "I'm valuable. Valuable." And in this situation, Jesus was, of course, without a doubt, extremely valuable. And he tried to go and just have some time. But he could not be hidden. "For a woman whose young daughter had an unclean spirit heard about him, and she came and fell at his feet." For a woman had heard about him and came and fell at his feet. She had a daughter possessed, a daughter in struggle, a daughter who is hurting. How many know when mama got a child that needs something? I was driving home the other day and I wasn't feeling real good, and I said, "I think I need to call my mom." Sometimes we feel like that, don't we not? And then I said to Angie, and she said, "What's wrong?" And then sometimes she'll just carry on. And she do. She'll soak me, and she'll get me food and do all those. Sometimes we need that, amen? But this girl was gone beyond this moment. This girl was possessed by a demonic spirit. This girl was in such a way that her mom said, "I got to get her help." And she said, "If I can just find where Jesus was." Now, can you imagine? She probably had to work past some people. I mean, where there's a way, mama will find a way. Amen? So this woman had to probably, he was hidden. He was trying to be hid. But she found her way in through wherever the situation was to get to the point where she's not just in a room waving at Jesus and singing out to him from afar. She fell at his feet. She was desperate. She was saying, I got to get to where he is. And then we read here. She says to him in Matthew once again, have mercy on me, O Lord, Son of David. My daughter is severely demon-possessed. But then the very next verse is this. But he answered her not a word. You ever had moments when you've talked to God and he didn't say a thing? You ever had those silent moments where, man, you pleaded your heart out? You cried out to him. Tears dripping from your cheeks. You're not just praying, now may lay me down to sleep or whatever kind of prayer. Not whatever it goes like, I can't even remember. Now I lay me, not now I need me. That's right. And you're praying this prayer, a desperate prayer. Have mercy on me. She's desperate. And Jesus answers, not a word. And his disciples came to him and urged him, saying, send her away, for she cries after us too. She's not just bothering Jesus. She's bothering his disciples. And do you notice that the disciples, they are not moved with compassion for the desperateness in her voice. They are not moved with compassion for the need that she has. They are not moved with what is going on. They are just moved with the annoyance that she just keeps bothering them. Because you have to remember, you're dealing with some people who look at this woman and recognizes that she's from Canaan. And if you know what that means, she's a Syrophoenician woman is the name of it, which she was an ancient enemies of Israel. And here she is now at his feet crying for mercy. And he says, send her away, for she cries after us. But he answered and said, I was not sent except to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And she came and worshiped him. There is something about worship, church. There is something about worship that we have yet to even begin to tap into the tip of the iceberg of what worship can do. See, because we so often are worshiping for a reason. And we are worshiping because sometimes of what we can get from God. This woman, he's not getting anything, but she worshiped him. This woman is not even getting words except for, I didn't come for you, woman. But yet, even in that response, she worshiped. What would happen to a church if we never got the answer we were looking for, still worshiped him? What would happen to a believer if when we go through struggles in life and situations where everything seems to hit us like a ton of bricks and we don't know how we're going to get out of it, and we seem like God is distant, we don't hear anything, even though we poured out our heart, what is it that happens when the church says, I'll still worship you, I'll still praise you, I'll still give you honor, I'll still give you glory? Because I know who you are. I know who you are. See, worship comes out of a relationship. A relationship. A relationship. Let's take this a little bit deeper. Send her away. And she came and worshiped him and said, Lord, help me. And he answered and said, it is not good to take the children's bread and throw it to little dogs. It was a common thing to refer to the Gentiles, to refer sometimes as just dogs, not of value. They're not important to us. They're not a part of what we're doing and where we're going. We're not here for that. And Jesus did exactly this. I believe that in that moment, I believe he had compassion. I believe in that moment, he was still the God who loved her right where she was. But I believe sometimes when God says these things, when Jesus is saying these things, I believe he is looking more for a response from us . How would you respond? How would you respond when you were expecting a miracle? How would you respond when you showed up expecting that this great man that you heard about that's doing all these miracles and healing people and setting people free and seeing blind eyes open, and you showed up and just saying, "My daughter, I need mercy. I need you to come. I need her to be healed." And you show up with this plea and this passion, and you hear the words of nothing. And then you hear the words of, "I didn't come for you." And now he's hearing the words that, "I'm not going to take the children's bread and give them to the dogs." Now, I know we've heard this before, but I want to take us to look at it from the worship perspective. Because right after all this takes place, this woman says these words, "Yes, Lord, yet even the little dogs eat the crumbs which fall from the master's table." Then Jesus answered her and said, "O woman, great is your faith. Let it be to you as you desire." And her daughter was healed from that very hour. What if she quit when he didn't answer? What if she quit when he said, "I wasn't here for you"? What if she quit when he said pretty much that, "I don't give bread to the dogs"? What if she quit through all those three times? Then she wouldn't have received her miracle. I don't believe for one second that Jesus would have chased after her and said, "Oh, I was just kidding, come on back." I believe without a shadow of a doubt that she would have walked away from that situation with a daughter still possessed, with a daughter still in torment, with a daughter that still needed a miracle, and with a mom still in devastation. But she would not let go. In Genesis chapter 22, we read about Abraham, and he takes his son Isaac, his promised son, that this is going to be the son that from him will be the descendants that will lead right on down to Jesus. "Here is a son. I'm going to make you the father of many nations. His name is Isaac." And God tells him to take him and to sacrifice him. And in Genesis chapter 22, Abraham is taking his son Isaac, and he talks to his servants, and he says to them this. He says, "Hey," he said, "wait here. My son and I are going yonder to worship, but we will be back." How many know when you go into worship, there is a thing that happens, and it's not a result if you go in saying, "I'm going to worship because I want this." It's a result that happens because when you go into worship with a heart that says, "God, I trust you beyond anything else that this life can offer me. I trust you. I believe you because of who you are." Abraham knew the character of God. He knew the heart of God. And he said, as we read in Hebrews, which we don't have time to turn to this tonight, but he said he knew that if God had raised his son from the dead, his promise would still come true. Why? Because his word, his promises are yes and amen. And he takes his son and he goes on yonder to worship. And he takes the greatest thing that he has, the promise from God, and he ties his son's hands, and he puts him on the altar. And I can't even imagine for a moment being in that position. I can't even begin to fathom what was going through Abraham's heart, what was going through his son's heart as he is putting his son up on the altar where a lamb is supposed to be sacrificed, and he takes the knife and he's about to do this very act. But an angel cries out and stops him. But the heart of Abraham to say, "God, I believe you, I trust you," and an act of worship was him and his son being right there, right now, to trust what God said beyond what he felt. Do you trust God beyond what you feel? That's a huge question. Because we all say it. And we all want to believe that. And we all want to walk in that. But if we stop to truly think about it for a moment, sometimes our words do not match up with our heart. Sometimes we say something, but we live something different. And I believe our life is supposed to be a life of worship. This woman lived a life of worship, saying, hey, she fell at his feet and she worshiped him, even when she never got the response that she wanted. But because of what she did get the response at the end. But her worship didn't come after. Her worship came before. And you know, your worship needs to come before your miracle. Your worship and your praise needs to come before you see it. See, genuine worship is an outward expression of an inward reality of knowing who God is. If you know who God is, how can you not but express that? If you know his heart, how can we not but express his heart? See, I was listening to a video the other day, and one of the statements that it made was this: you will become what you worship. And that is so, so true. The more that we worship our favorite television show, the more of the character traits, the more of the terminology, the more we worship a person. You ever notice that? I remember going to New Brunswick and speaking with a Newfoundland accent, and we all got a Newfie accent. I mean, a lot of us think we don't, but the fact of the matter is you don't realize it sometimes until you get into a place and people start saying, what accent is that? I don't got an accent. They're saying, no, yeah, you do. But we don't recognize it the same. But it was funny, in New Brunswick, the more I got there, the more I began to talk with people, the more my accent sometimes began to change a little bit. But the funny thing is, even though mine changed and I dropped some of the things that I used to do, they begin to pick up some of the things I did. Some of my terminology, they begin to pick up. So we had New Brunswickers talking like Newfoundlanders, and we had a Newfoundlander talking like a New Brunswicker. And we were just mixing it up. I remember we did a skip one time, and we walked into the back, and one of the things we had to say was part of it was we were looking at where we were. We were walking into heaven. So my New Brunswick friend was walking in, and he was saying, where is this? And I'm like, I don't know. Where are we to? Because when we say, where are you to? Most people in New Brunswick are like, what do you mean, where we're to? It's supposed to be where we at, not where we're to. And it's all mixed up. So I walked in, and I'm saying, where are we to? And my friend's walking in behind me. He said, where are we? And then he says, where are we to? And everybody just roared laughing. For the first part, I had no clue what was happening. Because to me, it was normal. But to him, it wasn't normal. But the more we spend time around one another, the more we begin to rub off on one another. And the more time that you spend worshiping God, the more you will become like God. The more you'll take on his traits, his characteristics, his heart, the more you begin to be who he's called you to be. Do you worship to get, or do you worship to give? The motivation of our worship is vital. We have to have a heart that, God, if you never do another thing for me for the rest of my life, I don't worship you for what you do. I worship you because you are God and you deserve the praise and the worship regardless. If you never do another thing, you are still worthy of my praise. And so often we worship God because of what we can get instead of what we can give. I have to give him my worship if he never does another thing for me. That's my heart. And the more that he sees your heart that worships him because of who he is, the more he looks at that and says, hey, angels, come here. Look after my servant. Look after my boy, Jon Rogers. Just look at him. And angels are looking and say, that fella with no hair? Yeah, that fella right there. They're looking at the outward appearance probably even. When God is looking down and he's seeing a heart. See, what is our heart in worship? See, a true heart of worship will worship just as much outside of this building than it does in this building. A true heart of worship will worship just as much in a seat as they will on a platform. A true heart of worship will worship just as much when things are going wrong and everything is messed up than when everything is going good and everything's all together. How can we know? Let's look at Paul and Silas. Sitting in a prison, beaten, bloody backs, in chains, for preaching the gospel. God, thanks a lot. Here, doing, you know, how many times have we ever talked like this? You know, God, I don't deserve this. God, I don't do this, and I don't do this, and I serve you, and I go to church every Sunday, and I lift my hand like this, and I sing praises like this. I mean, seriously, when we stop to think about it, so often we can think that way, and we can talk that way, and we think that we actually deserve something. I deserve hell. You deserve hell. I know we don't like to hear that, because who wants to deserve hell? Not me. But I do. But I don't get what I deserve. And you don't get what you deserve either. We get his love. We get his mercy. We get his grace. We get his passion that led him to this earth to die upon a cross and give his life completely and entirely for us. When I didn't deserve it, he still did it. While the Bible says that they were nailing him to the cross, when he was beaten, when he was hanging there, he was praying, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. What at heart? Do you worship God to get? Or do you worship God to give? She gave him worship. Moses went to give worship. If you look throughout Scripture, worship was sacrifice. I think we need to be God-centered in our worship. How many people, like me, are house worshipers? That you can't wait sometimes to be in your house by yourself. We used to live in houses with apartments, and this is, you know, the first house that we've been in that we haven't had an apartment underneath us or something along those lines. Before, we'd have apartments, so when we would turn music up, we had to keep it to certain volumes, and sometimes I'd be dancing or doing my thing, and I know there's, oh, someone just got home in the apartment. Oh, man, so I gotta keep my dance down a little bit softer, you know? But we live in a house now, when Angie leaves, sometimes in the morning, or I'm sure vice versa, we got these speakers in our living room that are hooked up to our TV, and we got an Apple TV, and we got brand new albums. I get all Angie's music playing through that, and I crank that thing up, and man, I'm in the living room, and I'm dancing. You think I get radical in church sometimes? If people would walk and knock on my door during my worship, sometimes in the morning, they would knock on my door and say, whoop, I'm not going in there, it's a crazy man. That should be normal for the church family. It should be normal for us to spend time. Listen, if you spend time in worship throughout the week, serving God, loving God, worshiping God with music playing, with your feet dancing, I promise you something. You will see your weeks go so much smoother. You will see your weeks with so much more victory. You will see your weeks with God showing up and manifesting himself in ways that you'll become the church and can't wait to tell someone about. Because worship is not a Sunday experience. Worship is an experience when you have a problem and a trouble, and you're going to worship him anyway. You're going to praise him anyway. If God never even answers your prayer, you're going to give him praise anyway. You could be engaged in ministry, but not engaged in God. You could be engaged in ministry, but not engaged in a relationship with God. In the way that we should. That's why you could see so many situations where people were great at performing, but not great at living. I want to be greater at living than I ever am at being able to put on some kind of show for a people. I want to have a heart that cries out to him, that God, I don't deserve all you do for me. God, I need your mercy. There was two people. Jesus gives the parable where the scribe had went into the temple and he had prayed, God, thank you so much I'm not like this tax collector. Thank you so much that I paid my tithe. Thank you so much that, you know, I don't live the life that he's living and so on and so forth. And he said, but then the tax collector prayed, I'm a sinner who needs your mercy. I need your grace. I know I don't deserve it, but I thank you for it. Which one was heard? Church, I want to see miracles, but those miracles will come naturally in a house of worship. Those miracles will begin to manifest without no one even laying hands on people in a house of worship. I believe without a shadow of a doubt, God is taking worship in this church to another level. I believe that. I believe there are going to be songs that are going to come out of this church that are going to be written while people are standing here worshiping. I believe that there are songs that are going to come out of this church from the seasons that we're in that I believe without a shadow of a doubt that are going to go beyond this body of people. I believe that. But it doesn't happen just right here. It happens in that prayer closet at home, amen? It happens when people learn what it is to truly worship God in truth and in spirit. I believe this quote, it was Bill Johnson who quoted this, I believe. It said, if people knew what God was like, and if people got a true revelation of his goodness and his mercy and his love, that most churches would have a problem trying to close their doors for the night. That there would be people not wanting to leave the house. I want to see that. I read about Azusa Street. I read about the Welsh revivals. I read about the revivals that have taken place in the bygones of history. And I say, God, where is that today? I don't want to be so busy with life that I forget what it is to be in his presence. I don't want to be so busy with ministry that I forget what it is to see his glory show up. Don't want to be so busy with our programs that we miss his program. I want to see God do what he wants to do and how he wants to do it. I'm expectant. Are you expectant? This woman, she could have walked away. And I'm challenging you here right now. Some of you got questions. Why is God not doing this? Why is God not showing up in this way? Why is this not happening? I've been believing for this many years. I've been hoping for this many years. I've been trying to do this for so long. Why am I not seeing what God has promised? I believe that we need to be busy with worship and watch those things take care of themselves. Sometimes we're so focused on what God is not doing that we're missing what he's doing. Let me say that again. I believe sometimes we're so busy looking at what God's not doing that we miss what he is doing. And let me tell you something, church. He's doing an awful lot. He is moving in ways that you can't even begin to imagine or dream. And sometimes we are too blind with our spiritual eyes because we're looking at everything through our natural eyes. I got to take you to a verse of scripture. I wasn't going to go here tonight, but I feel like I need to do this. In Kings, and I want to read a verse of scripture here. Elisha, he was passing through this community, and I'm going to paraphrase this stuff. It's in 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 8 is where it begins. But I'm not going to paraphrase this for the sake of time, and I encourage you to go read this yourself a little while later. That he used to pass by to this woman's house. It was a Shunammite woman. And as he would pass by, he would stay there quite often. So the woman said to her husband, hey, husband, the man of God, he passes through here quite often. Let's build a place in our upper room here, and let's place it in a bed and a lampstand and a nightstand and so on and so forth, so that when he comes, that he can stay here. And she was so good to the man of God as he would pass through that the man of God called for her, and he said, what is it that I can do for you? And she said, nothing. I just dwell with my people. All's good. And then his servant says, you know what? She doesn't have a son. And Elisha says, oh, okay. So the woman stood in the doorway, and he said, listen, this time next year, you will have a son. And she said, don't mess with me like that. Don't fool with me like that. And he says, it's going to be so. And sure enough, that time next year, she had a son. And the son grew, and the son was strong, and the son was living there. And it come to a point, the child grew, and now it happened in verse 18, that one day he went out to his father, to the reapers, and he said to his father, "My head, my head." So he said to his servant, "Carry him to his mother." And when he had taken him and brought him to his mother, he sat on her knees till noon and then died. Can you imagine? Here's a miracle. Here's a son. And then he goes out with the father. And then he comes back in and he dies. Can you imagine being a mom holding that son as he dies? She went up and she laid him on the bed of the man of God. She shut the door upon him and went out. Then she called her husband and said, "Please send me one of the young men and one of the donkeys. I may run to the man of God and come back." So he said, "Why are you going to him today?" And she never even told him he died. "It is neither the new moon nor the Sabbath." And she said, "It is well. It is well." I don't know about you, but that is worship. It's an understanding and a reality that God is able, that God is there, that God is going to still come through. And she says, "It is well." So here's what happens. Then she saddled a donkey. There's something about moms in Scripture, but there's something about moms in general. How many know you can be as shy and quiet as can be, but you mess with somebody's mama's little kid, and you watch mama is going to be mama bear. Amen? You know it's true. And we see the situation here right now. She gets up on the donkey and she said to her servant, "Drive and go forward and don't you slacken the pace for me unless I tell you. Just keep going." And so she departed and went to the man of God at Mount Carmel. So it was when the man of God saw her far off that he said to his servant Gehazi, "Look, the Shulamite woman, please run to meet her and say to her," isn't it interesting? "Say to her, is it well with you? Is it well with your husband? Is it well with your child?" So he went and he did this. And she answered, "It is well. It is well." Wow. Her son is dead at home, lying on the bed. Her husband don't even know yet. She's on a donkey, full steam ahead, and now she gets met by someone and says, "Hey, how's everything going?" "It's well." She keeps going. Now when she came to the man of God at the hill, she caught him by the feet. But Gehazi came near to push her away. But the man of God said, "Let her alone, for her soul is in deep distress, and the Lord has hidden it from me and has not told me." So she said, "Did I ask for a son, my Lord? Did I say, do not deceive me?" And he said to his servant Gehazi, "Get yourself ready. Take my staff in your hand and be on your way. And you don't, if you meet anyone, do not greet them. If anyone greets you, don't say a word or answer them. And lay my staff on the face of the child as soon as you get there." And the mother of the child said, "As the Lord lives and as your soul lives, I will not leave you." Now, do you notice that? She said to the servant, "It is well." She said to her husband, "It is well." But when she got to the man of God, see, I believe that we need to be so cautious in how we share things and who we share things with. But when you get on the feet of Jesus, now this is the man of God, but we need to realize that prophets in the Old Testament were pointing towards, of course, Jesus and all the things that he would do. But can you see, being at the feet of Jesus is like the woman with the issue of blood. She pushed through the crowd. She didn't stop to talk to anybody. She just wanted to get to where Jesus was. But when you get there, he knows. He knows. He knows. It is well. Church, there's something about worship that comes from a body of people that when the struggle is on, it is well. When things are going good, it is well. But there comes a point when we still need to pour our heart out. And there are right places, right people, right circumstances to do exactly that. I want to pour my heart out to the one who already knows my heart. I want to pour my heart out to the one who already knows the answers before I even have them out of my mouth. And I want to pour my heart out in worship. See, sometimes we're so busy asking God for what we need that we forget to worship him, because he already knows what we have need of before we even ask. See, long story short, and I don't have time to completely finish all this, but he goes to the house, and sure enough, the staff was put on the boy's mouth, but the servant comes to him and says, hey, he still didn't recover. He goes into the house, and he goes up, and he lies up on him, hands to hands, eyes to eyes, nose to nose, mouth to mouth, and he prays, and then he gets up, still lying dead, walks down and walks back and forth in the house. Then he goes back up and lies down, does the same thing, and he becomes warm, and the boy comes and sneezes 7 times, and then life comes back into him, and he's alive. But I believe that started with the confession of her mouth to her husband, it is well. To the confession of her mouth to the servant, it is well. And then getting to the man of God and grabbing a hold of his feet, I'm not going to let go until I see my son alive. I believe, church, there is a worship that's going to come out of this house. I believe this with a shadow of a doubt. There is a worship that is going to come out of this house, that there are people in the community that are going to walk in through the doors and walk in weighed down by society, weighed down by life, weighed down by hurts, weighed down by addictions, weighed down by struggle, weighed down by all the stuff that life has tried to destroy them with, and they're going to walk in through the doors and feel like they're floating. I don't know how else to describe it, but because the weights that have been on them are going to be lifted so fast, it's going to feel like they can fly. See, that's we need to see in worship. How does it happen? When a body of people understand that we worship him because of who he is. Who wants to be somebody who's used for what they can give? Imagine a friend like that. Imagine a friend that, because of what you can do for me, I'll hang out with you. It's like the story I shared today. You know, with the little boy who looks at his mom and he says, Mom! And for those that heard this, I'm going to repeat it. For those that never heard it for the first time. Mom, when I get older, I'm going to buy you a fur coat and a diamond ring and a Mercedes Benz. And she looks at the boy and says, wow, that's wonderful. She loves her son. That's great. But then her son gets out of hand and she scolds her son and says, hey, nope, don't be doing that. He gets upset and he points his finger at his mom and says, there goes your fur coat. There goes your fur coat. And sometimes, if God don't do what we think he should do, well, there goes hand number two. We come into his presence. You ever come into his presence, and because you know you did things wrong, you feel like you can't worship? Do you know I don't worship God because I'm right? I worship him because he's right. I don't worship him because I'm worthy. I worship him because he's worthy. And the more I spend time understanding who he is, the more I begin to understand who I am, and I can live out who I am in life. God wants you, church, to live out who you are. But I believe the more you worship him, the more you find out about yourself. You are created in the image of God. You will become what you worship. The more you worship God, the more you behold him, look upon him, I believe the more that you will see you and who you're supposed to be. Because he's the creator, and you're the created. And you won't find yourself in some psychologist. You won't find yourself in some medication. You won't find yourself in some self-help class. You will find yourself in the creator, because he created you for amazing things. I want you to take a moment and just bow your heads in this place. The worship team is going to come. I want a lifestyle of worship. I'd rather any day live a consistent walk with God than an experience where one day he's the best thing ever, the next day I don't know if I want to serve him. I want to know that I know that I know that I know that what I believe, regardless of what I feel. You're going to feel all kinds of things. But it's more important to know the truth than it is to feel the truth. It's more important to know the truth than it is to feel the truth. Spirit of the living God. God, I pray in the next few moments that God will go beyond selfish worship and that God, we will give you selfless worship. Worship that comes from a heart that says, God, you deserve every breath of worship I can give you. You deserve every word of praise that I can give you. God, you deserve all the glory and all the honor because you are God and I am not. You are the creator and I am the created. And we have been created to worship you. And Father God, we want to be a body of people that, God, we don't worship you for what you can do for us. We worship you for who you are. We're not friends with you because you're the richest of rich. I count it an honor that you call us friends. Because I don't deserve any of that. But God, I thank you for it. Wherever you are tonight, wherever you are in your walk with God, just as we're bowed in his presence here, if you're here tonight and you would say, hey, I want my heart to be right with him. I want my heart to be right with him. I want to give him a heart of worship because of who he is. Angie's going to lead us, and as you do, just encourage you to get up out of your seat. Find a place. It's okay if you want to come to this altar, if you just want to go and move into the hallway or wherever you want to go, but just find a place where you just move out of from where you are. And let's just begin to give him some worship in this house tonight. Worship him. Praise him. Just let it come from your heart. We worship you, Jesus. Name above all names.
God, I look to you. I want to be give me vision,
Jesus,
to see things like you do.
That's right.
In God.